Good evening. Glad you all can make it and all that stuff we're supposed to say at start. Colossians chapter number 4. Sorry, I'm not very polished. Working on it. I'll say this because this is what you're supposed to say, I guess, in the time that we live in. Our country's in a mess, isn't it?
Yes.
It's in a mess, but you know what? There's not a lot you can do about it. You can vote, you can rally, you can protest, you can pray. You should pray about it. But you can't change the fact that you're alive in 2021 living in the United States of America. And you can't change the fact that however this thing ends up, one way or the other, you're going to be living in this country, and you've had to deal with this mess so far, and you're going to have to deal with this mess as it goes on, and you're going to have to deal with the result of it. The only thing that you can change is whether or not you are saved and whether or not you have a good relationship with Jesus Christ. I would rather be in a mess with Jesus Christ than be in a mess without Jesus Christ. I'd rather be living in a country that's falling to pieces with my Lord and Savior than living in a country that's falling to pieces without my Lord and Savior. You know, if you weren't saved today, that doesn't change the fact this country's a mess. If you stop living for Jesus Christ, that doesn't make this country any better. Everyone's going to go through troubles. Everyone's going to go through trials and heartaches, and I'd rather go through them with my Lord than without my Lord. I'm thankful for Lord Jesus Christ and everything He's done for me and everything He continues to do for me on a daily basis. Colossians chapter number 4, let's read verse number 5. We'll pray together. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this night. Lord, we don't deserve to be here. And we are really, really thankful to be here. There's many people around this country and really more so around this world who have no ability to meet in a place like this with people as fine as this, with your word in our laps and singing the songs of the cross and of what you do for us and have done for us. And Lord, we're thankful that you've given us the opportunity to be here. Would you please help us to make the best of the time that we have here tonight? Would you help me as I try to present these truths? Lord, we pray that you would do a work here. Nobody wants to come here and listen to a man speak. We want to come here and listen to your word and hear your words. So we ask and pray that would happen tonight, that you would give me the words to say and the way to say them, and help us to listen and pay attention and be changed by your word. We're thankful for this book. Lord, we're so thankful you've preserved it for us and given it to us so that we can know truth and know it for sure and stake our lives upon it. And we ask and pray again that you'd help us and that you'd accomplish something here tonight that can only be accomplished with the help of your Holy Spirit. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Colossians chapter number 4. Again, we'll start in verse number 5. Now, we'll say this as introduction. If you remember the main theme, if you think back to our first couple lessons in Colossians, the main theme of the entire book of Colossians is lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ. The main theme is magnifying the Lord Jesus Christ. In this book, Paul addresses some false doctrine, but the way that he goes about it is not necessarily preaching against the false doctrine. He just says, look, why would you go for that when you have a Savior that's like this? Why would you go for that worldliness when you have a Savior that's this good? And so Paul spends the first 2.5 chapters or so in Colossians just lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ and bragging on the Lord Jesus Christ and magnifying the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in this later part of the book, he begins to speak about your conduct. He begins to speak about the way you live. And that is because you cannot glorify God with your words. You cannot magnify God with your speech if you do not also glorify God and magnify God with your life. That was the problem in the Old Testament with the Jews. They said with their mouth they were the chosen people of God, but their works didn't line up. They were glorifying God with the things they said, but the things they did not glorify God. That's the problem with the modern church. You go to a church, you can log on to one of these mega churches' websites, and you'll read a doctrinal statement that's surprisingly similar to ours. Sure, there's some things that aren't the same, but you'll read something and say, well, what's so bad about these people? I mean, it looks like they've got their doctrine right. And you go there, and they talk about how much they love the Lord Jesus Christ, but you can't only magnify Jesus Christ with your words or with your statements or with your doctrinal statement. You need to also be magnifying the Lord Jesus Christ in your day-to-day life. That's what the book of Colossians and really this entire book, the Bible, teaches us. So let's read verse number 5 again. Is this mine here? Is this mine or was this left here from earlier? You already had it, right? You good? All right, I'm drinking. It's from last week. I thought I tasted some algae. Colossians chapter number 4, look at verse number 5. It says, walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. So verse number 5, the verse that we'll focus on tonight, speaks of a wise walk towards them that are without. Your walk, your conversation, your manner of living before the people that are out there in that world. So first we're going to make a couple general statements about this verse, and then we'll talk about what exactly does a wise walk look like. The Bible says we're supposed to walk wisely, and so we're going to go to the Bible and see, how does God define a wise walk? See, I don't want to know how the world defines a wise walk. I don't even really want to know how Christian people define a wise walk. I want to know what God says. There's a lot of Christian traditions that aren't exactly correct. I want to know what this Bible says. What's a wise walk? So we'll try to accomplish that this evening. But first, just a couple general points that I think this verse brings out for us and is important in our churches. Number one, as you walk through this life, you will come in contact with lost people. The Bible says, walk with wisdom towards them that are without. The assumption from verse number 5 is, as you live your life, you are going to come before people that are lost. In your day-to-day life, you are going to come in contact with lost people, and that is not necessarily a bad thing. Okay, now we want to be careful. There is an aspect of biblical separation that we'll talk about in a bit, but God did not intend this Christian life to be some sort of monasterial, monk-like, hermit type of life where you become saved and then you isolate yourself from the world and you hide in your house and you hide in your church and you never come into any contact with any lost people. That's not the way that God set this up. Now, do you have to be careful? Absolutely, you have to be careful, and we're going to talk about this. We preach separation, and that's biblical, but separation is supposed to be separation from the practices of the world and not necessarily separation from the people of the world. Okay, now again, we want to be careful, because the first thing someone's going to do is go spend vast amount of time with lost people and say, oh, well, I'm trying to witness to them. And that's not right. That's not biblical. But on the ditch on the other side of the road, you have safe people who get saved and lock themselves in their houses because they're scared of ever coming in contact with the lost people. You have safe people who got really born again, and when they go out, they keep their head down and they stay to themselves and they don't talk to anybody, so they can get out of that grocery store as fast as they possibly can without ever having to talk to a lost person, so they get back to church and start fellowshipping with saved people again. And that is not biblical. You are going to come into contact with the lost people of this world, and the Bible has a specific pattern on how you should live or act towards those people. Now, let's show you this from the Bible. Come to John chapter 17, if you would. John chapter number 17. John 17. Look, the Bible says, love not the world. Okay? Love not the world, neither things that are in the world. We're not telling you to love the world. We're not telling you to fellowship with the world. But we are telling you that if you're living like a biblical Christian, if you're going to work, okay, if you're going to school, if you're going to the grocery store, you're going to rub shoulders with lost people. And that's what the Bible says. Look at John chapter 17. Look at verse number 14. And I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. When you got saved, if God wanted to, he could have immediately raptured you out of here. Okay? As soon as you got saved, God said, okay, it's my child. I'm taking him to heaven, taking her to heaven right away. Immediate personal rapture because you got saved. In fact, if you're a biblical Christian, you'd probably fit in better up there than you would down here. The Bible says we're not of this world. The Bible says we're a new creature. A spiritual man does not get along with the unspiritual world that we live in. But God did not take you to heaven as soon as you got saved, because if he took you to heaven as soon as you got saved, who would be upon this earth to witness to lost people? Who would be upon this earth to represent him? Who would be upon this earth to tell other people about Jesus Christ? And so it can be said quite accurately from the Bible, the entire reason you exist down here today is so that you can tell other people about Jesus Christ. The entire reason you exist is so that you can lift up the Lord Jesus Christ and teach people about the Bible and witness to lost people. Now, the Bible does say here that you're to be kept from the evil of the world. Many Christians want to hang out with worldly people and do worldly things and then say that they're trying to witness. You aren't fooling God and you're not fooling man. You're supposed to be kept from the evil that is in the world. You're supposed to pray and ask God to help you not to become evil by your walk in this evil world. But you're not to be taken out of this world. You're not supposed to be removed from the presence of lost people. You're just not supposed to let their filth and wickedness start to rub off on you. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. 1 Corinthians chapter number 5. I am not, you did not hear me say that you're supposed to go out into that world and find sinful places and involve yourself in those sinful places so you can be a lifestyle evangelist. Okay, that's not what we're saying. Oh yeah, I just go down to the bar and, you know, have a couple drinks with them and talk to them and sometimes I slip in there how great God has been to me, and that's not what we're saying at all. But look, you're gonna go to work, you're gonna go to school, you're gonna go to a store, you're gonna go to a place of business, whatever you do, you're going to come in contact with lost people. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, look at verse number 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Am I in the right verse here? I'm sorry, I'm in chapter 6. Here, look at 1 Corinthians 5 and verse number 9. I wrote unto you in an epistle not to company with fornicators, yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetousness or extortioners or with idolaters. For then must ye needs go out of the world. But now I have written unto you not to keep company if any man that is called a brother or a fornicator or covetous or an idolater or a railer or a drunkard or extortionator with such an one, no, not to eat. If you're going to say as a Christian, I'm just never going to talk to or keep company with a lost person or a wicked person or a fornicator or any of those other things, buddy, you're going to have to leave the world. Because you can't go through a day in your life without talking to somebody who's doing wicked things. You can't go through a day of your life without interacting with a lost person who is living the life that lost people live. God does not expect you, nor does he want you, to hole up in your home or in your church so as never to come in contact with a lost person. He wants you to go into that world and be a light and be a witness for him. Look, Jesus, the world uses this verse to act like it's okay to be wicked, but Jesus absolutely spent time with people you wouldn't want to associate and you wouldn't want your family talking to so that he could witness to them. Jesus spent time with the harlots and with the publicans and with the sinners and taught them and brought the light of the gospel to them just as well much as he did the religious people of the day, okay? So that's what the Bible says. You're going to come in contact with those people. A great example of this is Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah in the book of Daniel. They had no choice. They had no choice but to be very, very involved with a very, very wicked society. Yet they were able to be a witness for the Lord and stand up for God in that day, in that time, being employed in that kingdom without sacrificing their godliness and without becoming wicked themselves. They used that opportunity, they redeemed the time, and they stood up for their God. There came a time when the world showed up and said, well, we're going to throw you in a furnace. We're going to feed you to lions. And they didn't back down. We're not saying, you know, oh yeah, just be friends with the world and make everybody happy. And okay, they stood up for their Lord and said, go ahead, throw us in there. But they didn't leave the world in order to live for God. They lived for God in the world in which they were living, okay? So it seems to be kind of an issue sometimes in our churches is people want to totally isolate themselves and they want to totally just hole up and never talk to a lost person again. And one day we'll have the opportunity to do that when the Lord comes back. But until then, the Bible says you are going to have a walk towards them without. Make sure that it's wise and make sure you're redeeming the time. So what does the Bible define? How does the Bible define a wise walk towards them that are without? Number one, it's a good testimony. A wise walk towards them that are without involves a good testimony. Our goal concerning lost people is to win them to Jesus Christ, isn't it? Our goal concerning the world is to bring them the truth of Jesus Christ and bring them to salvation. Our goal is not to have, you know, a big supper and have them all in here. Our goal is not to make this church a place where they feel comfortable so we can intermingle lost. Our goal is for them to get saved and for them to get in church. But they are not going to listen to what you have to say about the Lord Jesus Christ if you have a bad testimony with them. Nobody's going to want to hear what you have to say if you're a liar. Nobody's going to have to hear what you have to say about God if you're a cheater. Nobody's going to want to have to hear what you have to say about God if you cuss or if you drink or if you behave yourself unwisely before them. The world knows better than saved people sometimes what is acceptable in the eyes of God. And if you live your life in a way that is unacceptable in the eyes of God and then you try to witness to them, they're not going to hear it. They don't want to listen to you. If you can't refrain from wickedness while you're in front of the world, and then you want to go tell them about how Jesus Christ changed your life, they don't want to hear it. That's what's wrong with this big movement, you know, let's just become just like the world so the world will feel comfortable with here. Why would the world want your Savior if your Savior hasn't done anything for you? If your church looks like a rock concert, and your church looks like a pool hall, and your church looks like a dance hall, the world doesn't want anything to do with it. They've got all that out there. Why would they come here for that? Your Savior didn't do anything to change you. They don't want to hear it. Right. You go to that job and you cuss just like them. Why would they want to hear about your witness, the Lord Jesus Christ? Right. You go to that job and you behave yourself just as rude as they behave themselves. You're just as unkind to people as they are to people. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear your gospel witness. So the Bible says when you're out there in that world, you need to walk with wisdom. Look, if they don't get saved because they don't love God and the Bible, they don't get saved because they're offended by your gospel witness, that's fine. You presented them with truth, and they rejected it. But if they don't get saved because you're just an all-around terrible person and they really don't want to hear what you have to say, that's not fine. That's your fault, okay? And so we're supposed to behave ourselves wisely towards them. I'm not saying that anybody here is an all-around terrible person. I'm not accusing you of that. But we need to walk wisely towards them that are without. A lot of Christians act as though it doesn't matter what lost people think about us. After all, they're just lost people, right? A lot of people act like I go out there and speak to them however I want. I'm on the street corner witnessing. I could call them whatever name I want to. They're just lost people. They don't get it. They don't have a clue. They're the dummies that don't believe the Bible, and they are, but that's not an excuse to behave yourself unwisely towards them. That's not an excuse to behave yourself in such a way that you're going to slam shut any sort of door of utterance you had open prior to that point. Okay, when we're speaking to the lost people or acting towards them, we need to be conscious because they're looking for a reason to reject your Savior. They're looking for a reason. Look, they're gonna hold you to a whole other set of standards than they're going to hold themselves. They cuss all day long. The second you say one little word that's maybe not even cussing, just kind of close to cussing. They're going to say, well, I thought he was a Christian. I'm not listening to anything that he has to say anymore. They're running their dirty mouths all day long, telling dirty jokes, and they tell one, and you're not thinking, and you just kind of crack a smile. They're going to remember that, and they're going to hold you to an unfair standard and judge your Savior based on your conduct. It's not right, it's not fair, but that's what they're going to do, and that's why you need to behave yourself wisely. Look, above and beyond what's reasonable. There's been times you're out there, you got to think, man, if I say that, it's right and it's true, but they're going to take that and twist it all around and mean it to make something it wasn't meant to say. If I do that or go there, there's nothing wrong with that, but some lost person's going to look at that and twist it around and hold that against me, and so I just got to refrain from that. You got to do that in church sometimes too. If I say such and such or so and so or say something to somebody, I know I didn't mean anything like that, but they could take that the wrong way. So you got to behave yourself wisely. Behave yourself wisely towards them that are without. Sometimes we behave ourselves wisely in here because we care about what people think about us. But when we leave those doors, we let our guard down because, okay, I'm away from church people, and now I can kind of relax, and I can dress how I want, and act like I want, and talk like I want, and the Bible says that's the opposite of what you're supposed to do. You're not supposed to be a fool when you come to church, but you're supposed to be double wise when you leave here. When you go out in that world, you've got to put your guard up, not let your guard down. If you're in here and you say something dumb, as Christians who believe the Bible, we're supposed to say, okay, you know, they shouldn't have said that, they shouldn't have done that, they shouldn't have acted like that. We're supposed to love them and give them grace and try to help them grow. And even if they offended me, I'm supposed to love them anyway and just give them time to continue in this word. And if it really bothered me, I could talk about it and we can work this thing out and grow together as Christians. That's what Christians are supposed to do for other Christians. That world ain't going to do that for you. That world's not going to give you the benefit of the doubt. That world's not going to give you time to grow. That world's not going to say, you know, I bet you they didn't really mean it like that. Let's just let them grow in the Lord a little bit longer. That world's going to take any opportunity they have to say, well, I'm not listening to him anymore. I'm not listening to her anymore. They said this or did that, and I thought they were a Christian. Oh, I'm not going to that church. Okay? So we need to be wise towards them that are without. Like a soldier entering enemy territory, a commentary put it. I thought that was good. You know, you leave, this is where you're safe. Unfortunately, Christians are so mean sometimes, you really do have to have your guard up around them. But this is where we should all be able to relax and enjoy fellowship one with another. And out there is where we really, according to the Bible, need to be wise and behave ourselves wisely. Come to 1 Peter chapter 2. Got a lot of verses to look at here. 1 Peter chapter number 2. This is all throughout the Bible. Your testimony as a Christian. Very, very important. 1 Peter 2 and verse number 12. 1 Peter 2 and verse number 12 says, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas ye speak, they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Your conversation, which is your manner of living, is to be honest before people that are without. So though they speak evil of you, they'll look on your works and say, I could speak as bad as I want about him because he's a Christian, but I really can't find any way to accuse him. I can't find anything he's doing that's wrong. Come to Titus chapter 2. Run these verses quickly because they all give us the same idea. Titus chapter number 2 and verse number 8. Sound speech that cannot be condemned. That cannot be condemned. That he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. You need to watch your mouth when you are out in the world. And I'm not just talking about cussing, okay? Sound speech which cannot be condemned. But before you need let those words come out of your mouth, you need to stop and think, is there a way they could condemn this? Is there a way they could use this against me? Is there a way they can twist this and use it in such a way to blaspheme my God or hold it against me and not come to Christ because of it? And you say, well, people are going to be unfair. We're going to talk about that in a minute. We're definitely going to address that. But come to 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. This is God discussing the qualifications of a bishop. You say, well, what's a bishop? Let's just suffice it to say that it's church leadership, okay? As somebody that's in a leadership position in a church, and God is about to set forth the characteristics of a church leader upon which he is not willing to compromise. God's going to say, if you're going to appoint a bishop, this type of leader, he's going to have to meet these qualifications. Look what one of those qualifications are in verse number 7. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. God says, if you're going to appoint a bishop in your church, he is going to have a good report with them that are without. That's a qualification on which God is not willing to compromise. That Christian leader needs to have an exemplary life, not just in the church, but in his day-to-day business when he's working with the world. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, let's look at that one. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians 4, this is going to be the second time this honest walk appears. Look at 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 11. That you study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we command you, that ye may walk honestly toward them that are without, and that ye may have lack of nothing. The world, look, you start witnessing to somebody about the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're not going to say, well, where do you stand on the rapture? They're not going to say, well, how do you divide the 7 years? Are you mid-trib or pre-trib? What do you think about Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2? They don't care about that stuff. They don't know about that stuff. But if you steal from them, they're going to care about that. If you slack off, if they're a hard worker and you're not, they're not going to want to hear what you have to say. The Bible says, walk honestly towards them which are without. If you are a dishonest person, they don't care how right your doctrine is. They're not going to want to hear your witness. Now, I'm not accusing everybody here of being dishonest, but we need to be wise. We need to be careful towards our walk towards the unbelievers. Come to Romans chapter 16. Again, we're trying to dispute this idea that, well, it doesn't really matter how you live out there as long as you live right here. And this is usually our walk in here And our personal walk with the Lord is usually the focus of our preaching and the focus of our Bible study, and that's rightly so. But sometimes I think we give the impression that as long as you're doing right here and doing right at home, when you're out there in the world where nobody can see you, it's just kind of whatever. And it's not just kind of whatever. And if anything, you should be more concerned about how you're acting out there than in here. It disturbs me. I know this is a touchy subject, and I'm not trying to hurt anybody when I say this. But if you come to church and dress right because you're in front of church people, how much more so should you go out in the world and dress right in front of worldly people? If you want to hold the line when you come here because, well, this is what's right and this is what the Bible says and this is, then you should be just as much, if not more so, inclined to do right when you're out there. Because the world is going to look at you and say, well, they dress one way on Sunday and another way when they're out here. That don't really make any sense. And you can apply that to any area of your life. Well, they talk one way when they're here. They talk differently when they're out there. They act one way. Okay, I'm not singling out dress, but I think that's a big one. Music. We come here. We don't sing any. We would never listen to any song that's ungodly here. You wouldn't start playing secular music here. But if you do it when you're out there, what kind of double standard is that? The world's going to pick up on that. That's not a wise walk towards them that are without. Look at Romans 16 and verse number 19. For your obedience is come abroad unto all men. I am glad therefore on your behalf. But yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. The Bible says that their obedience came unto all men. How did their obedience come unto all men? I don't think the world came into their church service to see if they were dressed right and had the right music. I don't think the world came to their church service and said, wow, they've got really good doctrine. I highly doubt that lost people are browsing our website and reading our doctrinal statement. But lost people are watching you when you go into that world and live in front of them. And your good works will come before them and your bad works will come before them. This church of the Romans, the Bible said that all men everywhere knew about their good works. Why? Because when they left their church, they still lived right. When they left these four walls, they still lived like a Christian. When they left their homes, they still took their godly walk with them and walked wisely before them that are without. Again, the world's not going to come here and say, oh, wow, well, I guess these people do know what they're talking. They're dressed right, they're acting right, the preaching's right. Look, they're using a King James Bible. The world's not coming here to figure that out. They're watching you when you go out there and seeing if you're living like a Christian ought to live. Okay, now there's a couple more things we have to say to qualify this. You say, and it's a fair question, it doesn't matter how good I am, and it really doesn't, they're just going to make something up about me. And that's true, and that's unfortunate. I've heard, there's somebody on Facebook saying that us on the street corner were grabbing people's strollers. Unless something happened please confess if that was you. But I'm about 101% certain that nobody here grabbed some lady's stroller as they walked past on the street corner. You know what that's doing? That's bringing a bad report about us. And that's bringing, there's probably somebody that read that and thought, well, I'm never listening to those street preachers again. But it simply wasn't true. So what do we do when somebody lies about us? What do we do when we're just living our life like we ought to live our life and somebody totally makes something up terrible and awful about us? Come to 1 Peter chapter 3. The Bible, this is what the Bible says. Perhaps easier said than done, but this is what the Bible says. 1 Peter chapter 3. Look at verse number 16. Verse 15. 1 Peter 3, 15. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Now, they don't have to like your reason, but you ought to have a reason. I had somebody stop me on the street corner one time and say, well, that really, it's not, you don't have any proof. That's not good enough for me. The Bible says you're supposed to have a reason to the hope that's within you, and you don't have a reason. I had a reason. He just didn't like it. I got a Bible that says Christ died for my sins. If you don't like that reason, well, I'm sorry. You don't like the reason that God gave you. You don't need to prove what you believe is right to every lost person that asks, but you should have a reason for what you believe, be able to go to the Bible and show them. But look at verse 16. Having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you, as evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. People are going to lie about you. The lost people are going to make things up about you and about this church that just simply aren't true. The Bible says the solution is just live a good life. Live by the Bible every chance you get when you're in front of those lost people so that they will be ashamed when it comes to light that they were just totally lying. So when somebody walks past the street corner with a stroller and says, I heard these are stroller grabbers. And they walk past and we say, hey, how are you? Can we give you something to read? No. Oh, okay, great. Have a good day. They say, oh man, I feel really bad about judging those people. I feel really bad about thinking that they were going to grab my kid out of my stroller because you know what? They're just good people trying to tell other people about the Lord Jesus Christ. When the rumors go around at school or work or unfortunately at church that you're just this terrible person, live in such a way that those people that spread that rumor will say, you know, I shouldn't have done that. They're actually a really good person. Live in such a way that the people who hear that rumor or that lie would be a better word for it, know that it's not true because, you know, I don't know what that person saw or think, but it can't be so. It can't be so about this person. We have a good testimony in our community. There are people, that, I like this, there were people one time during some big event in Mount Airy that went out there and were just rude to people and nasty to people, holding signs and preaching and calling people names and being just ugly. You're going to hell. In Mount Airy during, I think it was autumn leaves or something like that. Police came up afterwards. They ended up getting removed and I think maybe even arrested or in big trouble, got kicked out. They came up to us afterward and said, yeah, we knew it wasn't you guys. We knew that was some other group. That couldn't have been you guys. We know you guys don't do that. We know you guys are respectable and you behave yourselves properly when you're out here. That's what this verse is talking about. When somebody says, I heard those street preachers down there screaming and telling people they're going to hell, the people say, well, it must be some other street preachers, not Bear Trail, because we know that they behave themselves well when they're out there. Okay, so the Bible says when people lie about you, and it's a when, live in such a way that they might be ashamed. Now come to Galatians chapter 1. We need to make this qualification too. Galatians chapter number 1. This is a very important thing to consider. See, because the world we live in, they've redefined Christianity themselves without ever consulting a Bible. It used to be if you were for sodomites, sorry, I said it when it kicked off the internet. It used to be if you were for sodomites, everybody knew you weren't a Christian. Now if you speak out against that wickedness, they, well, that's not very Christian. You're supposed to love people. And just totally redefined Christian. It used to be if you compromised with the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons and the Catholics, then well, you must be some sort of lightweight. Now if you don't say, well, everybody's okay as long as they're sincere and everyone's going to heaven, is well, that's not very Christian. You what do you mean I'm a sinner? That's not a Christian thing to say. You're supposed to tell me that God loves me. And so this world's got such a convoluted idea of what actual Christianity is. So what's going to happen is you're going to go out there and live a Christian life, and they're going to look at you and say, you're not living like a Christian. You're supposed to love everybody. You're not living like a Christian. You're not supposed to call sin, sin, and right, right, and wrong, wrong. It's important to understand that we are not trying to please people. We're not trying to please men. Okay, I'm not going out there trying to make people happy. That's not what I'm telling you to do, but we are trying to walk wisely and have a good testimony with people. And the problem with the modern church is they really blur those lines. They think if people don't like me, then I must have a bad testimony. That's not what we're saying. Our goal isn't to go out there and make people like us. But if people aren't going to like you because of the gospel, let it be because of the gospel. I don't want people not to like me because I was rude towards them. I don't want people not to like me because they disagree with my politics. I go out there and preach Trump, and then they don't want to hear about my God because I was talking about politics. I'd rather just leave the politics out of it and let them not like me for Jesus. Because at least I got to witness to them before they decided they didn't like me. Look what Galatians 1 says in verse number 10. For do I now persuade a man or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. So we're not telling you go out in that world and live in such a way that everybody likes you, and if they don't like you, you're not doing right. Okay, if you preach Jesus Christ, there's probably going to be a lot of people who don't like you. But let the reason they don't like you be because of your God and your Bible and your stand on truth, not because of your bad or unrighteous conduct. Okay, so that was point number one, a good testimony. What is a wise walk? It's a good testimony. We've got a couple more here that should go a little bit quicker, but it's early. We still got plenty of time. Number two, It is redeeming the time. Come back to Colossians chapter number 4. I think it's early. I don't know when we started. Colossians chapter number 4. Yeah. It's only 6 o'clock where I'm from. We're just getting started. Colossians chapter number 4. I'm going to take the liberty to take a little extra time because everybody was so mean to me during Bible conference. I got called Absalom. I got called mean. I got called a Yankee transplant. It's just not fair, man. Colossians chapter number 4. Look at verse number 5 again. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. Redeeming the time. Now, Christians have all sort of little catchphrases that are good, and they're from the Bible. But the problem is we so entirely divorce them from their context that when Christians hear that verse, they think it means something entirely different than it actually means. Okay, for example, an eye for an eye. You hear that all the time, but without the context, you really don't know what it means. How about, the truth shall make you free? And so don't tell lies, because lies will bring you into bondage, and if you tell the truth, you'll be free. Always tell the truth. That's not at all what that passage means. That passage says, if you continue in my word, then ye shall know, and then you are my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you, make you free. Okay? Sorry, a little NIV coming in there. Make you free. The context of the passage is if you learn the Bible, you'll know more truth, and then you'll be free from being deceived by things that aren't true. How about this? I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. So I can get a touchdown, and I can win my basketball game, and I can, whatever it is, I can do it through Christ. There's a context to that. There's a specific list of things the Bible says you can do through Christ which strengtheneth you. And it's not necessarily anything. There's a specific list in that passage that that's talking about. This redeeming the time is one of those instances. You hear people say, well, you know, I listen to sermons on my way to work because, you know, redeeming the time. And that's good and that's true. And you could go to other passages and make that application. You just can't go to Colossians chapter number 4 and make that application because there's a context to the statement that fits right into everything else we've been talking about. Look at verse number 3. With all praying for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I'm in bounds, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, comma, redeeming the time, period. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how ye ought to answer every man. The entire context is you having an open door to speak as you ought to speak as you walk in front of lost people with speech that is gracious and yet seasoned with salt. That's the context of the statement, redeeming the time. So here's what we're trying to say. We said you're going to have to go into the world and come into contact with lost people, right? The Bible, if you're biblical, that won't be an extended period of time. It might be a 30-minute lunch break. It might be a trip to Walmart. It might be just a short time at school. The Bible says that little bit of time that you have in front of the lost people, make it count. Redeem that time. Take that time and use it to stand up for the Lord Jesus Christ. God help me. I got 2 minutes with that cashier at Walmart. God help me not to talk about the weather. God help me not to talk about, this mask, yeah, I hate it too, ha, ha, ha. Why not talk to that person about Jesus Christ? I got 2 minutes. Look, if you knew for a fact, and this happens to you every single day, and you do know it for a fact, you just don't think about it like this. If you knew for a fact you're going to see a person, and you're going to see him for 2 minutes, and you've got one thing to tell him, what would it be? All of our answer would be, I'd tell him about the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, then start doing it. Because you're in that situation every single day. If somebody said, if you've got 1 minute to talk to Donald Trump, what would you tell him? I think all of us would tell him about the Lord Jesus Christ and make sure he was saved. You run into people every day you're only going to meet one time for 30 seconds. Hand him a tract. Tell him about the Lord. Redeem the time that you have out there. If you're biblical, you're not going to be spending vast amount of time with lost people. So take that little bit of time that you have and make it count. Look, you got an hour on the street corner, and each one of those cars, you've got one sentence on one sign. Let's make sure the sign's facing this way and not this way. Or not upside down. Or backwards. Or you got one rotation of that light. It's pretty easy to do. Look, I do it too. We get talking and we're not paying attention. But you do this and now this line of cars could see you where they couldn't if you're doing this. You got one rotation to get those people. You got them driving past for a second. Make that time count. That person might be from Nebraska visiting Mayberry. Do that S start to come out. I was going to say a word there, but it's Mayberry, okay? And you have one opportunity to hand them a gospel tract. God help us if we're not paying attention. And they get, oh, somebody walked past. I missed them. Redeem that time. You can talk while you're, I'm all for fellowship. It's one of my most favorite parts of the street corner, okay? But don't forsake the lost people walking by because you're talking to your saved friends on the street corner. I've done it, you've done it, we've all done it. Let's redeem the time that we have out there. Use that little bit of time to tell the world about Jesus. I like to finish this quickly. I know I'm pushing it here, but number three, what's a wise walk in front of the world? It is a good witness. Closely related to what we just said, we're talking about redeeming the time, but also witnessing. Look at, I guess you could combine these 2 points if you're taking notes. They are very, very similar. But Proverbs 11, verse 30 says, "The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise." A wise walk towards them that are without is somebody that's witnessing. And then lastly, a wise walk, Ephesians chapter 5, includes being cautious of the dangers that are out there. Sometimes it's hard to set forth Bible truth because there's always a road and a ditch on both sides. And because of time constraints, you usually only get to address one of those both sides. And it's hard sometimes you give people the impression, you got to be careful that you don't get unbalanced. So everything we said is true. You're going to have to come in contact with lost people. You're going to have to be out in the world. But at the same time, as you're doing that, you do need to be cautious. You do have to walk circumspectly, as the Bible says in Ephesians 5. Look at verse number 15. "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise." Circumspectly means cautiously, with watchfulness every way, with attention to guard against surprise or danger. As you walk through this world on your job, at your school, or even on the street corner, you need to be careful. Because there are, not physical, spiritual dangers and surprises and snares everywhere you go. You can't isolate yourself, you're not supposed to, but part of a wise walk towards them that are without is being careful of the dangers that are in this world, okay? Your kids want to bring lost kids from their school to VBS, praise the Lord. Those lost kids call next week and want to hang out with your kids all week. Not so much, praise the Lord, okay? That's probably something you need to be careful of. That's something you need to be wise about. That's something you need to be walk circumspectly about. Witnessing to a woman on your job, praise the Lord. She says, "Oh, that's interesting. Do you want to go to lunch alone tomorrow?" No. Okay? Walk in the world, but be careful as you're walking to the world. Go to work and deal with lost people. That's necessary. It's not necessary to hang out with them after work. It's not necessary to go bowling with, "Oh, we're all going out to do such and such and so and have a Christmas party." And look, be careful. Limit your time. Do what you have to do because there are snares everywhere. The Bible says our adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. We aren't trying to contradict what we said earlier. You can't go out of the world, but while you're in this world, you need to use some wisdom. Look, I know people who won't witness because they're scared that they might accidentally see a lost person doing the kinds of things that lost people do. And that's not right, okay? But at the same time, be careful. If you're going to go preaching in front of a bar, don't go by yourself, right? If you're going to go preaching in places that are dangerous spiritually, don't go alone. You got a testimony to uphold. Okay, so that's all we've got for this evening. Walk wisely towards them that without. Next time we meet, I don't know if it'll be before Bible school. Yeah, I think there's another one in there. We'll talk about your speech being always grace seasoned with salt. Is there anything you didn't want to say, brother? Yes, sir. All right, Brother Tim's coming.